Hi, I'm the History Guy. I have a degree in history and I love history. And if you love history too, this is the channel for you. 38 years ago today, the entire world was looking to the sky. The event was worldwide news at the time, but it seems to have faded quickly from the public memory. And so today, on the anniversary of the day that it fell to Earth, the contributions of America's first manned space station, Skylab, deserve to be remembered. The idea for manned space stations actually started with military space stations. The idea would be to have a manned station that could be used for observation and spying, and perhaps even to shoot down enemy satellites. The United States proposed the Manned Orbital Laboratory program in 1963, and the Soviets answered with the Salyut-Almaz program. The Soviets actually put manned military stations into space, but the enthusiasm on both sides waned as it became obvious that unmanned observation satellites were much more cost-effective. But both sides leveraged the idea in order to apply it to manned space stations for civilian research. In the United States, this is part of what was called the Apollo Applications Program, a program that was designed to leverage the technology that had been invented for the Apollo moon landing program, as well as to guarantee jobs for the people who had been trained for the Apollo program. The basic idea proposed by scientist Wernher von Braun was to use the cylindrical tube that was the second stage of a Saturn V rocket as a living space. The McDonnell Douglas Corporation was given a contract to do the appropriate modifications in 1969. And in 1970, NASA held a public contest to name the new station, and that's how the station got its name, Skylab. Skylab was the first time that NASA had to consider habitability. The previous manned space programs had all been short duration. The Apollo missions lasted less than 2 weeks. Astronauts would be expected to stay on Skylab for extended durations, requiring considerations for such things as living space and more palatable food. The final station would be about 282 feet long and hold 12,417 cubic feet of pressurized, habitable space. Skylab launched on May 14, 1973, but almost immediately things started going wrong. At the maximum point of vibration during the launch, an important heat shield broke off and tore with it one of the station's solar panels. When the station got into orbit, it turned out that damage from that accident prevented another of the solar panels from unfolding, and the station was dangerously underpowered. Turning the station so that the remaining solar panels could get more sun then caused the station to overheat because it had lost its heat shield. The mission to send astronauts to the space station, which was supposed to immediately follow the launch, had to be delayed 10 days as NASA came up with a repair plan. The crew of the first manned mission to Skylab, launched May 25, 1973, using an Apollo program command module, was sent with a repair plan. Mission commander Charles Conrad said upon launch, "This is Skylab 2. We fix anything." They are able to effect repairs using innovative fix-it solutions and two unplanned spacewalks. It was, at the time, the largest such repair ever done in space. That experience produced the first lesson from Skylab: that the unique ability of people to conduct unexpected repairs makes them invaluable to space exploration. Without the ability to send humans to effect repairs, the entire project would have been a loss. Skylab orbited the Earth from 1973 to 1979 and was occupied for a total of 171 days out of that time, with three manned missions, each exceeding the previous human record for days in space. In that time, astronauts performed 10 spacewalks, totaling 42 hours and 16 minutes. Skylab logged about 2,000 hours of scientific and medical experiments, making massive strides in observation of the sun, including the first videos of solar flares, as well as Earth observation that was previously impossible, producing a vast study of the Earth, its crops, weather, and changes in the environment. Crews manufactured alloys, grew perfect crystals, and learned to work in space. But the greatest contributions may have been in understanding manned space requirements. Astronauts in Skylab learned how to move, how to bathe in the first zero-gravity shower, how to cut their hair in space. They learned lessons about exercise and remaining fit that would be critical for future missions. There were ambitious plans to save Skylab for the future. The systems were still operational and ready for habitation in 1978, 4 years after the last manned mission to the station. The hope was to have the space shuttle program ready in time to have a mission to boost Skylab's orbit. But it was not to be. Greater than expected solar activity had warmed the atmosphere, increasing friction on the station and hastening its orbital decline. And the space shuttle program was behind schedule. On July 11th, 1979, Skylab, America's first manned space station, fell to Earth. NASA tried to use station telemetry to position the station to fall into the ocean off of South Africa, but it took longer to burn up than predicted, so some debris landed in Australia, but it caused no damage. When Skylab crashed to Earth in 1979, it was a worldwide event, but it was more of a celebration, really, than any kind of fear. One company sold an aerosol spray can that promised to be a Skylab repellent, and they promised a money-back guarantee if it didn't work. A town in Nebraska painted a huge target on the ground to give NASA something to aim at. A family in Western Australia won a $10,000 cash reward from a Philadelphia newspaper for being the first to recover pieces of Skylab. And a county in Australia fined NASA $400 for littering. Skylab was not the first manned space station in orbit. That honor actually went to the Soviet Salyut 1 station, but that was a troubled program. The first group of cosmonauts that were sent to Salyut 1 weren't even able to dock with the station and had to return to Earth unsuccessful. The second group managed to fix the docking problem and spent 3 weeks on Salyut 1, but then they were tragically killed in an accident on re-entry to Earth. The station was never used again. But still, in the Skylab era, the Soviets put up 6 different manned space stations. And after Skylab, the Soviets put up the Mir space station, where cosmonauts broke all of Skylab's records for the amount of time that a human spends in space. The Soviet experience was also critical to the lessons that were needed to be learned in order to provide a permanent human presence in space, a vision that has been realized with the International Space Station, which has been permanently manned since November of 2000. Still, Skylab played a critical part in the role of human space exploration and habitation. It was the station that proved that humans could live and work in space for a long time. It was the program that filled the gap between the Apollo program and the space shuttle program, that piece of time when NASA went from wow events to a going business concern. It was a pioneer in the human habitation of space. And it deserves to be remembered. I'm the History Guy, and I hope you enjoyed this edition of my series, 5 Minutes of History, short snippets of forgotten history, 5 to 10 minutes long. And if you did enjoy, please go ahead and click that thumbs up button, which is there on your left. If you have any questions or comments or would like to suggest other topics for the History Guy, please write those in the comment section, and I will be happy to respond. And if you'd like 5 minutes more of forgotten history, all you need to do is click the subscribe button.